Welcome back on my YouTube channel. Did you know that QGIS has many different algorithms available for stream and catchment delineation, and you can choose between different alternatives for your workflows? This is a big difference with proprietary software, where you're normally stuck with a one-size-fits-all workflow or a very limited amount of options. Different options are important if you work on your own study area, where you might need different choices of algorithms to get the best results. In this video, I'm going to dive into all these alternatives that are available. But first, let's have a look at why QGIS is such a great flexible integration platform for GIS tools. QGIS itself is built upon several powerful underlying open source packages and frameworks to provide comprehensive geospatial data analysis and visualization capabilities of the software. There's GEOS, a library that provides spatial operations and functions for handling geometric objects. It allows QGIS to perform tasks such as buffering, intersection, and union of spatial features. The Proj4 library handles cartographic projections and coordinate transformations. GDAL and OGR are used for reading and writing raster and vector data formats. Then there's also the Qt framework. Qt is a cross-platform application framework used for developing the graphical user interface of QGIS. It provides the tools and libraries needed to create the user-friendly and interactive interface that QGIS users interact with. Built on this is the QGIS processing analysis framework, which provides a set of tools and algorithms for spatial data analysis. A lot is core functionality, but it also allows to develop plugins, custom scripts, and also to integrate third-party tools from so-called processing providers. Here are a few examples. These third-party processing providers are made available in QGIS using processing provider plugins that link the third-party GIS software to the QGIS processing analysis framework. Because processing provider plugins integrate very well with the processing analysis framework of QGIS, they differ from the conventional plugins. They add new algorithms or tools to the processing toolbox, which then can also be used in the model builder to create graphical models. It enables batch processing. Python classes are created for these plugins. And this is besides all the other options that you have with the conventional plugins, such as adding menus and other Qt interface objects. It's sometimes confusing for users how to set up these processing provider plugins. The main reason is that in the past, some of these processing provider plugins were shipped with QGIS, such as SAGA, GRASS, and OTB. This has been changed. I think only with the standalone installer, these packages come with QGIS. And in other cases, you need to separately install the third-party software and the plugin and create the link between the two through the processing provider plugin or settings in the processing toolbox. One of the available processing provider plugins is the PCRaster Tools plugin, which provides a link between the PCRaster software and QGIS. PCRaster is a powerful software package designed for dynamic environmental modeling, supporting distributed raster-based simulation models. Its Python framework also allows for stochastic modeling and data simulation. It's widely used, especially in hydrology and ecology. Its over 100 optimized functions that are available through Python are useful for building models and also to do map algebra analysis. PCRaster also comes with its own visualization tool, Aguila, and it has extensions for linking, for example, PCRaster to Modflow for groundwater modeling. Here's a little history of the PCRaster Tools plugin development. In 2020, I started experimenting with PCRaster and QGIS in a Conda environment. That was because QGIS and PCRaster were both available through CondaForge, and also it was the only supported way to install PCRaster. In this way, I could prototype the plugin using processing scripts that I could share through the resource sharing plugin. When this was ready, I contacted Niall Dawson from North Road to develop the plugin further to be made available through the plugins repository of QGIS. We've launched the plugin on 24 September 2021. Since then, it has been downloaded more than 65,000 times. In the second edition of the book QGIS for Hydrological Applications, I've replaced the SAGA workflow with the PCRaster workflow. Thanks to Jürgen Fischer, it's now also possible to install PCRaster through the OSGeo4W installer, but it still works great on Conda for all operating systems. Therefore, now around 100 map algebra operations are available through the processing toolbox. In the stream and catchment delineation workflow, we can use tools from different processing providers to make it more tailored to our study area. The generic workflow is that we first need to download the DEM. If it's provided in tiles, we need to stitch those tiles together, which is called mosaicing. Then we often need to reproject the DEM because we can't use a geographic coordinate system. We need to clip the DEM to a smaller area. We need to interpolate voids. Very important to fill the sinks. Burn the stream network if there's a stream network available to force the water to follow the hydrography in a more realistic way. Calculate the flow direction. Derive the streams, define the outflow point, and then derive the catchment of this outflow point. There are two useful plugins to download freely available global DEM data. With the Open Topography DEM Downloader plugin, you can download DEMs from opentopography.org. You can create a free account and get your API key and download one of the DEM products that is suitable for your study area. The plugin also adds a tool in the processing toolbox, which makes it possible to integrate downloading of DEMs in your graphical models. An alternative is the SRTM Downloader plugin, which only gives access to the 1 arc second SRTM product, which is approximately 30 meters at the equator. It will download the separate tiles for an extent and then stitches it together in a virtual raster. I've noticed that this sometimes goes wrong when the internet connection is not stable. It will still create a virtual raster, but some of the tiles are missing and that causes errors. If you have DEM tiles instead of a complete raster, you need to stitch them together, which we call mosaic. There are several options in QGIS to mosaic. You can use from the core tools merge, which merges the tiles into one raster. This of course creates a lot of duplication of data. If you want to avoid that, the recommended way is to build a virtual raster. This will create a small XML file which virtually stitches the raster tiles together. The PC Raster Tools plugin also offers a tool for mosaicing, which is the resample tool. There, a user can select different input rasters of different dimensions and resolutions, and they will be mosaiced and resampled to the dimensions of a raster mask layer. An important step, especially when you have downloaded global DEM datasets, is to reproject the raster, because global datasets are usually in the geographic coordinate system with units in degrees. For the correct calculation of DEM derivatives, like you need to do in stream and catchment delineation, you should reproject to a coordinate reference system. Let's demonstrate this using a curve. On the x-axis I have a distance, and on the z-axis I have elevation. If I draw a curve and I want to know the slope of this point on the curve, I need to draw a tangent line. Then I can calculate the arctangent of delta z over delta x to get the slope. However, when z is in meters and x is in degrees, I will get wrong results. Therefore, a reprojection is important. Now, this is not the only problem when we deal with rasters in GIS. We don't have a curve. We have a raster where each pixel has an elevation value. How do we calculate the slope of a raster? Therefore, we need to use a so-called focal operation. In focal operations, we use a moving window or kernel of certain dimensions that moves over a raster, does a calculation and assigns it to the center pixel. In this case, with all the slope functions, we use a 3x3 moving window and we calculate the slopes to each direction, which means in this case 8 different directions. And we assign the steepest slope to the center pixel. In this way, we create a slope raster. There's one disadvantage. We lose information on the sites where there's no data in the kernel. Therefore, you need to always choose your study area a little bit larger than strictly needed if you want to apply these kind of focal functions. Some of the next steps are very calculation intensive. Therefore, it's important to reduce the size of your DEM as much as possible. If your DEM is too large, the calculation times will be too large or your computer will run out of memory. But if you make it too small, the catchment boundaries are cut off and you have straight lines in the catchment delineation procedure. So you need to use some expert judgment on how far you need to clip your DEM. The tool that you can use for that is from QGIS Core, which is Clip Raster by Mask Layer or Clip Raster by Extent. Sometimes your DEM has voids. These are pixels with no data. They need to be interpolated first before we proceed with the rest of the procedure. We can use one of the core tools in QGIS, which comes from GDAL, which is fill no data. A very important step in hydrological analysis of digital elevation models is to fill the sinks. DEMs often have artificial pits in the landscape, and these pits are a set of one or more cells which have no downstream cell around it. These pits need to be removed for a correct flow of water to the outlet. The pits are removed using fill sinks algorithms. However, if the landscape contains real sinks, such as lakes or wetlands, these need to be added after the pit removal. In the picture, we see a pit in the middle with an elevation of 2, and we see that all the water gets trapped into that pit. Algorithms can remove pits by filling up the pit or by cutting through the pit. For filling sinks, there are many algorithms available from different processing providers. And that's a good thing, because you will find out during your studies that you probably need to test different options to get the best results for your study area. So SAGA and WhiteboxTools use algorithms from Planchon and Darboux and Wang and Liu. PCRaster has the LDD create algorithm, which uses an approach where you can control the filling with different parameters, as you can see in the picture. It, however, results in a flow direction raster. If you're interested in the filled DEM, you need to use the LDD create DEM. GRASS offers the Jensen and Domingue algorithm. The next step, if it's not done by the fill sinks algorithm, is to calculate the flow direction. Flow directions are compass directions, but we cannot store characters in rasters, so we need to store 0 to 360 degrees for the compass directions. One problem, we exceed 8 bits, and 16 bits would be too much. With 8 bits, we can store values from 0 to 255. Maybe you remember from the slide on calculation of slope that we only have 8 directions and we don't need all the directions. This is called the D8 or single flow direction method. Now the problem is that different tools use a different encoding for these flow directions. And these flow directions are called D8 flow pointer raster. You can see that terminology in some software. For example, ArcGIS stores it as 1, 2, 4, 8, 16, etc. PCRaster uses encoding which is similar to the directions of the arrows on your numeric pad on your keyboard. SAGA starts with 0 in the north and then goes clockwise. And then GRASS starts with 1 in the northeast and then goes counterclockwise. Also note that there's a value in the middle which represents cells which have no flow direction. These are the pits. So in ArcGIS that's minus 1, PCRaster uses 5, SAGA 255, and GRASS has null. Although the D8 algorithm is the most simple and popular one, it might cause challenges in certain landscapes by deriving the flow direction. If you encounter these challenges, you might want to try one of the other algorithms that are available in different toolboxes. For example, the D-infinity or multiple flow direction algorithm is useful when you have divergent hill slopes. It can also handle ambiguous topography and minimizes overdispersion. So different processing providers can calculate flow direction but use different encodings or different pointer rasters. WhiteboxTools has most options for calculating flow direction using different algorithms. It also supports different pointer rasters. If you want to mix tools from different processing providers in your workflow, it is very important to understand that you need to reclassify the flow direction raster to the encoding that is expected by the next tool that you're going to use. And the way of doing that is using the reclassify by table from QGIS Core. If you have a river network layer available, you can make the flow directions more realistic by burning in the river network in the DEM. And there are different tools you can use. So WhiteboxTools has the fill burn algorithm, GRASS has r.carve, and there are some custom PCRaster user scripts that you can download through the resource sharing plugin. After calculating all the flow directions, we can connect the arrows and create the stream link. This already gives us an idea about the streams. The next step is to delineate the streams. We can use two different methods, Strahler orders or flow accumulation. In both cases, we need to calibrate the results using a reference GIS layer. This can be a river network on a topographical map, or a satellite image where we can clearly identify the river network. Because both methods will assign a value to every pixel, we need to determine the threshold value, the minimum value for which we can consider a pixel a river. In other words, what's the minimum Strahler order or the minimum flow accumulation to consider a pixel part of the river? The Strahler order method works as follows. We assign an order of 1 to the smallest tributaries upstream. When two tributaries of the same order join, we increase the order. You can see that for orders 1 that flow into an order 2. When two of order 2 join, we get an order 3 downstream. However, when a smaller order joins a higher order, and it's not the same order, we don't increase the order downstream. So here, when order 1 joins 3, it remains 3. 2 of 3 will become 4. When we apply this to a raster, every cell will get a Strahler order, and we need to do this calibration to determine which cells belong to a river. QGIS has several algorithms that we can use from the processing providers. The stream order algorithm of PCRaster calculates the Strahler orders. WhiteboxTools also has the Strahler stream order algorithm, but it also offers other methods of ordering tributaries of rivers. For the flow accumulation method, PCRaster and WhiteboxTools offer most variety in available algorithms. From the most simple accuflux function, which simply accumulates material downstream, to more physical realism in the algorithms. GRASS offers the R-flow algorithm. For more information about the flow accumulation functions in PCRaster, I refer to another video on my YouTube channel. The next step is to define the outflow point of your catchment. There are different terms for that. It can be called an outlet, a pour point, or an outflow point. It doesn't matter where in the river network you want to define it to find the upstream contributing area, but it's very important that you snap it to your delineated stream. The streams that you see on a reference map or a satellite image do not necessarily correspond with your delineated stream network. So there are different tools for defining outlets or calculating the catchments from those outlets. You can define outlets automatically by using, for example, the PCRaster pit tool and then feeding the results in the catchment tool to derive automatically the catchments of those pits. If you manually identify points as an outlet, then you can use from WhiteboxTools some snapping tools to snap those points to your delineated streams. So there are different tools that automate part of the procedure and some even up to the point that you get your vector layers out of it. So that's a lot of manual work, but if you want to automate things, that's quite easy because these processing provider tools are well integrated in the processing analysis framework of QGIS, and you can create graphical models or scripts. This is covered in other videos and in tutorials on gisopencourseware.org. Once you've created models, you can share them with others. There are two ways. You can use the resource sharing plugin. That's also useful if you want to share processing scripts. If you want to share your graphical models, the best way is to use the QGIS model hub. And in another video, I show how that works and how you can download models from the hub using a plugin. At the end of this video, I want to point out a few tools for enhancing the visualization of your hydrological results. And a very nice one is visualization using arrows. Therefore, you can use the crayfish plugin to convert your PCRaster or SAGA flow direction rasters to a mesh format, grip, and use the mesh styling panel to add nice arrows to your map. A very recent development in QGIS is that you can animate rasters using the temporal controller and having a timestamp per band. I explained this in another video. If you like these videos, don't forget to subscribe to my YouTube channel and you will receive updates. See you next time.